In this video series, we discussed bait and wait for ants. We caught cockroaches on sticky boards, we tried to think like a rodent, and we took a look inside the tunneling system of a toothy gopher. Now we'll deal with something stationary, but something that's still a challenging pest. Turfgrass weeds. Dandelions, crabgrass, clover. Why are they a problem? First of all, most people would say a weed-free turf looks better. So it's mostly aesthetics. But weeds can also be a safety hazard. Safety hazard. Slipping on broadleaf plantain can cause sprained ankles, and some weeds, like star thistle, have sharp spines. Clover and other flowering weeds in turf attract bees, and bees can sting students. And if a student or staff is allergic, weed and bee management will become a big issue. Fast. Achoo! Ugh. Achoo! Weeds. They're just plants that grow really well in places where we don't want them to. Weeds do well in places that are hard for turf grass to live in, such as in dry, salty, or compacted soil. They love open areas and disturbed sites, like those old gopher mounds or in that area at the center of the football field. Incorrect irrigation, fertilization, or mowing can weaken turf grass and is likely to bring on a weed invasion. Weeds can either be annuals or perennials, and the type of weed you have will decide your management strategy. If you have spotted spurge, crabgrass, annual bluegrass, or burr clover in your turf, you're up against annual weeds. Control them when they are at their smallest before they produce seeds. If you're fighting kikuyu grass, dandelions, or white clover, you're up against perennials, which are the bullies of weeds. Perennials may seem to die during the winter, but come spring, they pop up again even stronger and bigger from their roots and underground stems. So stop them while they are young and remove the parts of the weed below the soil surface so they don't pop back up or spread. So let's grab our clipboards and head back outside and meet up with our landscape IPM professional, Phil, to see what we have. Hey, Phil.
Oh, hey, how are you doing?
Good, looks like we've got some weeds out here.
Oh, sure do.
All right, well, what is the best way for us to look for them that makes sense for IPM?
Well, what I like to do is about once a month, I want to come out and do a transect in the field. That is a systematic evaluation of what the condition of the field is and what weeds are growing. If I do it on average once a month, and if I do it in a systematic way, then I can evaluate whether the problem is increasing or decreasing, whether I have to make any kind of significant management changes.
Makes sense. What do we got here?
Well, one way to do it is a line transect. There's a lot of different ways to do a transect. The important thing is that you do it consistently each time. This is one method. It's a 15-foot line, and what we would do is just throw the line out. Do you mind bringing that over here? I'm going to pull this line over here.
Right here?
That's just about right. Exactly perfect. I would lay that out. I'm going to grab my clipboard. And what I'm going to do, I'll do this multiple times through the field, at least three times. And what I'll do is look down here at foot number one. I don't see any weeds. Okay? So, one is zero. Two, no weeds. That's a zero. Three, we've got something here. And to be honest with you, I don't exactly know what it is. So I'm gonna take a sample and we'll identify it inside. So we brought the weeds in from the outside and we've identified them. And in that area that we were sampling, what we had primarily were clover and knotweed in this wild heliotrope.
So what's the underlying problem out there?
Well, the goal is to make the soil healthy. What this tells us is that the soil conditions are better for these weeds than it is for the grass. So we need to turn it around and make the soil healthier for the grass than it is for the weeds through aeration and better fertility and better irrigation management. Now, if we had found Dulles grass or nut sedge or other plants that like wet soil, that would have told us that we needed to change those conditions to make the grass healthier.
So the underlying problem is underlying.
No, this
it's
is.
The soil.
It's the soil.
That's punny. Thanks a lot, Phil.
That's my pleasure.
Turf has it hard. It gets stressed by too much use, not enough rest, not enough maintenance. Stressed turf is susceptible to invasion by weeds. Carrie is a University of California environmental horticulture advisor and turf management expert. Carrie, we've just heard from Phil that soil problems can encourage weeds. So to keep our turf healthy and competitive against weeds, we need to make sure that our soil and turf are properly managed. How do we do that?
Well, the first thing you want to do is start with the right amount of water. You want to make sure that you water deeply and infrequently, and you want to apply the water either very late at night or really early in the morning. That way you avoid the wind and the heat and the sun that can evaporate the water. It's better for the grass, and you save water.
Okay, so we need to set irrigation timers. For how long?
Well, there's no magic number for how long you run an irrigation timer. What we need to do is match the amount of water that your system delivers with how well your soil infiltrates water, the turf type that you have, and of course, the weather. And it's really important that the water gets applied evenly over the turf grass, so you need to walk around and look for dry spots or look for soggy areas. If you walk across the grass and your footprints stay in the grass, that's drought stress. But if your foot sinks in to soft soil, then you're probably overwatering that area. So a really good way to analyze that is through a catch can test. So you take a large number of cans, same size, and you distribute them all over your field, and then you run the sprinklers. And walk around and see how much water after the sprinklers are turned off is in each can, and you'll see pretty quickly how little and how much you're putting down.
It's a neat trick. All right, so now our turf is properly watered. What do we do now?
Well, you're probably gonna need to fertilize. Most turf grass needs fertilizing, and the best time to do it's in the spring, and then again in the fall. In the spring, you get the grass growing, and then in the fall, you replace the nutrients that the grass used to grow and that you removed when you were mowing it. So for turf grass, mostly that's nitrogen, but it could also need potassium or phosphorus or iron.
Okay, so how do we know what we need to add when we fertilize?
Well, you're gonna have to have your soil tested by a soil lab. That test will tell you exactly which nutrients you need and how much you need to add.
So we check the soil.
Right. And then after you add the right type of fertilizer and the right amount, you're gonna need to water. And that'll carry the nutrients down into the root zone. You may also need to aerate any compacted areas.
Aerate, what's that about?
Over time, soil gets compacted, and that makes it really difficult for air and water and nutrients to move through the soil into the root zone. Weeds don't seem to mind this, but turf grass has a tough time. So it's a really good practice to aerate your turf grass at least once a year.
Okay, so we irrigate, check the soil, fertilize appropriately, and aerate. Anything else?
Well, there is one more practice you can use to really help suppress weeds, and that's to overseed. Now, overseed doesn't mean to use too much seed. What it means is to spread seed over the grass that's already there so that you fill in any holes that have come up with new fresh grass. Now, you want to make sure that you use high-quality fresh seed, and the best time to do it is in the spring or in the fall. But anytime you notice bare spots, you're going to want to come in and overseed so that the weeds don't come in instead.
And there it is, the keys to a healthy and good-looking lawn or turf without a pesticide in sight. Thanks a lot, Carrie.
You're welcome.
Is she gone? Okay, so what happens if you follow all of Carrie's advice, but you don't get Carrie's results? What else should you be doing? Well, are you mowing regularly? Mowing makes the turf look well-groomed, removes weed flowers, and reduces the chance of a student tripping or slipping. Just follow the one-third rule. No more than one-third of a grass blade is to be removed at one time. And leave the grass clippings right where you cut them. Recycling the grass puts valuable nutrients back into the soil. You should hand weed regularly. Remove the weed while it's still young, before it sets seed. Be sure to remove the entire weed, roots and all. The last choice is herbicides. Use them only after weed prevention, fixing irrigation issues, soil improvements, overseeding, aeration, and other management methods have failed. No single herbicide controls all turf weeds, so you have to choose carefully based on the season, the weed type, and the turf grass species. That's where your monthly Transect line monitoring will help. Herbicides can be pre-emergent, used before weeds come up, post-emergent, used when weeds are young, selective, used to kill specific types of weeds, like broadleaf, and non-selective, which kill most plants. Read the label carefully and follow instructions precisely. In fact, if you do use herbicides, strike early. Remember, new young weeds take less herbicide and are easier to manage. And apply herbicides when school is not in session to reduce potential exposure. Turfgrass IPM comes down to a few simple points. Set acceptable levels for weeds in each of your school's turf areas. Keep the turf healthy with good watering, fertilizing, mowing, and aerating. Hand pull weeds or use other mechanical methods first, and reach for herbicides only as a last resort after all other methods have failed. So now you know how to manage turfgrass weeds. But what if your pest problems are bigger than you can tackle on your own? Hire a pro. We'll talk about that next.